Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone, and welcome to our webinar, Adaptations in Crisis, Stress Testing Our Intentional Design Model for Girls Programs. We will feature the experiences from Ethiopia, Lebanon, Bangladesh, Mozambique, Guatemala, and the Indigenous communities of the United States. This presentation is brought to you by the Population Council's Community Practice. My name is Sophie Suarez, the COP's Project Manager, and I am so pleased to have your attendance here today. This webinar is being presented on April 29th, 2020, in the midst of the COVID-19 crisis. And we hope that you will find the material included in here and information useful no matter the crisis, as we continue to face many challenges on the ground that are quite acute in girls' lives. I want to also welcome and celebrate our featured speakers today, Annabelle Errol-Carr, Sajida Amin, Rima Murtada, Angel De Valle, Katia Almeida, Alexandra Machado, and Kelly Holman, as well as our project director of the Community of Practice, Judith Bruce. Explain what the Community of Practice is, and a few of our new resources, and then turn it over to Judith Bruce. So what is the Community of Practice? For those of you who are unfamiliar to it, in the Community of Practice, our clients are the girls. We are building an evidence-based and systematic practitioner-centered approach to impact the lives of girls globally. And we work with institutions ranging from large multilateral and bilateral organizations and governments to small community-based organizations and national and regional networks. What we do is we work with practitioners to build their capacity to lead evidence-based change, deliver coverage with quality, shape and capture resources and entitlements, and innovate content through young female-centered structures deployed by a cadre of mentors. And we do this by supporting practitioners in designing, implementing, and evaluating effective, scalable programs. Programs that really build protective assets, those health, economic, cognitive, and social skills that girls really need to get through life's hardest transitions, especially those who are the most off track of adolescent girls. And this is really the foundation of what we call our intentional design approach, our stepwise process through which we guide practitioners. This process is really about moving through a cycle of segment-specific information collection and analysis, and a real process of critical insight and revision as you are both designing, implementing, and evaluating your programs, as well as scaling them up. And what we do is we provide tools and exercises that complement this approach. They are user-friendly and they really help you apply more rigor in your work, creating opportunities for collection and interpretation of information that is both visual and easy to understand. We are really looking for how we can bridge that often felt gap between being a practitioner and being a researcher. How do we make sure that the information and results we are seeing out there are most impactful to girls? Who are the segments for whom it would be the most impactful? So before we move on, I just want to show you one of our most exciting resources that we're all very proud of here at the Council and in the Community of Practice, our new website, buildcommunityforgirls.org. Here we hope you will find all the resources that we have developed over the years and continue to develop practitioner-driven, user-friendly, practitioner-centered resources available to you and more tangible and accessible to you. I just want to go through some of the features of this site and then we will take it from there. First, on the About page, you will find a little more on what we mean when we say intentional design. Our community of practice, how it works, some information about our really fantastic team, not only
population council staff, but a cadre of expert consultants who are deployed around the globe, one of whom you'll be hearing from today, the fabulous Rima Murtada, and where we work. And I'm just going to highlight the where we work page because I think it's really valuable. This will continue to get populated. It is a work in progress, but here you can see the breadth of the places in which we have worked, the sites where intentional design has been implemented, where our partners are and have been working tirelessly on the ground, as well as the tools and resources that have been adapted into a multitude of languages. Here you can see those languages, and again, the kind of the breadth of areas in which we have worked. I highlight these maps because I'm really hoping as you take a look at them, you are either seeing your own country highlighted or at least a context with which you are familiar, can relate, a language you know, so that you can kind of start to feel that connection to this work. Next, I want to highlight our field experiences. This is our blog page. There will be a number of stories often written by our partners in our partners' voices on how the practical application of intentional design and a myriad of steps in that process has worked on the ground, how it's been effective, the challenges it's produced, the successes, and most importantly, the learnings. The first story, and again, this will continue to be populated, comes from Nadia Assad and Sarah Blake, our fabulous team members, who write here about the introduction of green technologies, solar-powered mobile phone charging stations in rural Sierra Leone. And I will say, that it was a really fantastic and really interesting story to read. They don't hide away from not only the successes, but the real challenges and discomforts that came with doing an activity like this. And as a result, the real learnings that I think we can all take away from an experience like they'd had. So I really encourage you to read the rest of it. And I also really encourage you to leave a comment. I hope as I go through this site, you can appreciate and see that this is meant to be an interactive space. We want to hear from you just as much as we hope you want to hear from us. And so we do really encourage you to interact with the site, to leave comments, and participate in ways that are possible. Next, if we go to practitioner resources, you will see there it's sorted into four categories: essential reading, tools, program content, and webinars. I'll start with essential reading. As it opens, essential reading is really made up of journal articles, reports, and publication series that will ground you in our strong evidence base, in the main concepts that kind of undergird what we mean when we say intentional design, what we mean when we say girl-centered, and so forth. Again, I encourage you to read through this. There's a reason we call it essential reading. It's because we have seen its value over and over again on the ground to really emphasize, again, these key ideas. Under tools, you will find our open source toolkits and guides for really leading you through this intentional design process, from using data critically to identify where you will work, to creating mentorship structures, to how to create measurable benchmarks of success in your program. And we really, again, encourage your thoughtful review and use of the below resources. I'm just going to highlight a few. All of these are invaluable, but I know that there are some that I think will really stand out to you. And again, I really just encourage you to visit this site and look at all of them. But the first and relatively new one is from our Girl Innovation Research and Learning Center at the Council, or Girl Center for short. And this is the Adolescent Data Hub, a unique global portal that shares and accesses data on adolescents living in low and middle income countries. It's very user friendly. I again really encourage you to take a look. It's very transparent and collaborative in its environment. The other is the Adolescent Experience in Depth Guides that draw principally on data from the DHS. These guides create analyses specifically on the adolescent girls and boys and young women category from 10 to 24 years old. They include guides from 51 countries across 5 global regions, and our aspiration in the next several years is to continue to update them. But I think you will find the data presented not only digestible in graphs and tables and a lot of visuals, but useful to you as well. The Building Assets Toolkit, for those of you who have not heard of it before, supports practitioners in kind of identifying stepwise achievable benchmarks for their girls by age, social category, and context. Again, it's a really digestible and friendly tool, and I would encourage you to visit this site, especially because we've seen expansions on it in the last several years, adaptations that have been made. Here you'll be able to find our specialty decks on technology, on creative assets for mitigating trauma, and our assets for humanitarian context too. The IMAGEN Network, the Indigenous Adolescent Girls Empowerment Network, which you will be hearing about later from Kelly Hallman, has also developed their own set of assets for the Native American context here in the United States. EGR is the Evidence for Gender and Education resource is a relatively new one I'm really excited to introduce. I encourage you to contact my fabulous colleagues who actually developed this resource themselves, Meredith Kozak, Stephanie Pisacki, and Nicole Haberland, if you're interested in learning more. But I do also encourage you to visit this. It's an easy-to-use interactive database to help gender and education community make informed decisions about their programming and their investments in particular. And again, please contact my colleagues if you have more questions. They can tell you all about it, and I encourage you to take a look. And then finally, although by no means the only ones that are important, but I want to highlight the goal roster. Many of you here on the line have heard of it before. Here is where you can visit if you want to sign up to access the tool for yourselves, for your organization. It often serves as the entry point into the work that we do. And for those of you who are not familiar, it really is a very quick, easy questionnaire applied in home, walkable communities that can help staff see a fuller view of girls' lived realities and sort girls into meaningful segments so they can start to create that segment-specific intentional design in their programs. Again, one more time, by no means the only ones here, but some of the ones I wanted to highlight. Program content, as we make our way to that page, is our curricula and guides covering a range of subjects from financial literacy to nutrition to health and to education. All of these curricula, I think you will find, are highly adaptable, and some are available in multiple languages. These are from 6 of the Population Council's most successful projects. So I again would ask you to take a look, see if these are of interest to you. They run the gamut in terms of subject areas. And finally, there is webinars. Our webinars here, again, will continue to be populated, but these are some of our most interesting ones we think we wanted to highlight on transsexual sex, mentors, how to delay child marriage. If you might be viewing this webinar currently on this page, and that all future webinars will be recorded and placed here. And finally, I just want to quickly highlight our interactive learning. Here you can find conversations, compelling stories, we hope, multimedia stories from our colleagues and friends who are working on this work. It will be interactive, instructive, and informative, typically a conversation or a dialogue between us or colleagues with other practitioners on the ground. And the one that's highlighted this month is from Judith Bruce, who you'll be hearing from shortly, who interviewed Aisha Dennis, the former director of Women Now for Development. Women Now is one of our partners in Lebanon, working on reaching girls in the Syrian diaspora. You'll be hearing more about that project from Rima Murtada a little later on. So I would really encourage you to go ahead and download and read about this wonderful work that they've been doing. And finally, I do just want to encourage you to contact us for any inquiries you might have. at our community of practice at popcouncil.org.email. And if you did not receive an invitation to this webinar directly from that email, it means you are not yet subscribed. So I would really encourage you to please submit your email address and your name so we know who you are and subscribe to our newsletter. We'll continue to populate this page with newsletters from our archive. We've only sent one out so far, so you haven't missed too much. And our newsletters will continue to feature new resources, new opportunities for learning like this one, and much, much more. With that, I will pass it now on to Judith Bruce. Thank you.
Good morning, afternoon, and evening, and many thanks. I thought I would begin with some existential musings, given that it's been a dramatic 6 weeks for most everybody. These were slides, the first two we've been using for about 6 years, but I felt that they kind of centered us on our problem statement. So the first shows you, observes that the ozone layer protects the earth. Next. But social connectedness protects humanity. And the word I hear most often in the midst of this crisis is trust, governance. How do we make things work for human beings? And our initial impetus for the work with what we call the Girls Left Behind was to focus both on excluded communities and within them, girls who we felt, if supported, could revivify their own lives and prospects and would be an anchor for revivified and resilient communities. Next slide. In our initial model, we speak about running programs across the full seasons of a year, the seasons of risk, so that the not only the opportunities but the risks a girl rises to are visible and we prepare her. I think this has even more meaning now, as we see our theory of change is a fact that change will continue, that we have COVID now, but previously we've had, and you'll hear stories, we've had hurricanes, we've had drought, we've had Ebola, we've had seasonal flooding, we've had earthquakes, and many of our partners have struggled through this, providing support to their communities, but also at the same time, the girls finding their own voice and protecting their own selves. In humanitarian emergencies, which are often complex and multiphasic, adolescent girls and young women are a crucial population that take on at least four roles. They are the household managers of other younger families' welfare, family members' welfare, whether it's homeschooling, helping them wash their hands, keeping them safe, childcare, getting them to school, being role models. They are the co-partners, the co-parents, the co-providers, often of their mothers. They look after the older dependents in the family, which in most parts of the world, as health improves, there are more and more older people in households that need support themselves. They are, we think, the first line protectors of their own well-being. We want them to not only know their rights, but have the health, social, economic, and cognitive assets to claim their rights. And in claiming their rights and protecting themselves, they lay their own longer-term foundation, but as crucially, that of the communities that they're part of. Child marriage robs an entire community, not just of a girl, but of a potent force for change. I'm going to focus my last few minutes on the last role, which has gotten less attention, which is that of being the social first responders. Next slide. This will just be in the deck you see. It gives a bit more detail on the first three roles, that of looking after younger household members, that of being both partners and supporters of older household members, and their role in protecting themselves and working through peer networks to create, you know, a healthier growing up atmosphere for girls of their age and of their type. Next slide. So in the multiple settings in which we work, and you'll hear the huge variation by subpopulation, by sublocation, and by subpopulation, we have a reach here, and one that I think is really worth taking on. There's a transformation point at hand. In humanitarian emergencies, these girls can become, and their mentors, the mentor structures around them, and the female-centered girl-centered programs, can be the social first responders. They have access inside households and outside households. And many of the decisions, the preferences, the behaviors, food access and so forth take place inside households. They can influence the outside household directives, their realism and how they're implemented. They are architects of foundational and resilient health promotion and delivery of health assets. And they can strengthen community governance, which is often not associated with them, but I think of these short-term investments in crisis as laying the foundation, the kind of governance structures and trust and transparency, particularly as communities are confined, so that like an earthquake, like a house prepared for earthquakes, it shakes from side to side rather than falling straight down. Some of the presentations you're about to hear will give examples of how they have participated in, this is often the mentoring structures, and can be in community and ad hoc crisis planning groups, how they have gained control and are delivering safely new resources to those most in need, including food security, which isn't just an emergency resource, but a long-term health prevention resource. How they are engaged in safe public execution of caring and civic education roles, leading by example and action. And I think fortifying people's faith in each other as they rise to these occasions. They can craft understandable and trusted messages that are respectful of the scarcities of water, of hygiene, and plausibility of social distancing, for example. And they can serve as ongoing source of updated information, sort of a BBC of girls. And they can influence other messaging and delivery platforms like community councils, like school outreach, like places of worship, like midwives and traditional health practitioners. This can be a transformative moment. I like to think that about this crisis, I'm sure each of you has risen to many occasions in the last few weeks, and we will need more. I'd like to hand it over at this point to my colleague, Annabelle Arulkar.
Annabelle, you can go ahead. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, yeah, I just did. Thank you very much, Judith. So I'm Annabelle Arulkar. I'm the country director in the Population Council's Ethiopia Country Office. And for the next few minutes, I'm going to be talking about a recent experience we had in trying to keep contact and engagement with girls in one of our programs during this recent period of confinement due to COVID. Before I do that, I'm going to say a few words about the program as well as the girls themselves. Next slide, please. So Barutesfa means bright future in Amharic, and this is a girls' safe spaces program focusing on education for out-of-school, very marginalized girls residing in low-income urban areas or slum areas of Ethiopia. And we really do reach the most marginalized girls, including child domestic workers, rural urban migrants, and girls with disabilities. The program is supported by Girls Education Challenge, DFID, with previous support from a number of donors, including PEPFAR, UNFPA, the World Bank, and United Nations Foundation, among others. So in February, under the Girls Education Challenge project, we had just mobilized our girls groups and started to meet in safe spaces to deliver our education. And then within 1 month, we had to suspend due to stay-at-home orders in Ethiopia. During that 1 month, we did collect some data, including some background information on our participants, as well as telephone contacts. And we assumed that we could use these telephone contacts to maintain engagement of girls in the program during the suspension. So before I tell you about our experience in pre-testing using telephone to reach girls, I'll tell you a little bit about the background of our girls. At the right-hand side of this slide, you can see who our beneficiaries were. Two-thirds of them were younger adolescents, age 10 to 14, and two-thirds of them were also migrant to the area. One-quarter self-identified as being a domestic worker, but fully 40% reported that they performed 35 or more hours of unpaid domestic labor in their households, which meant even if they didn't self-identify as a domestic worker, often as a distant relative who's brought from a rural area to help out in the household, they were effectively domestic workers. And then also they had low levels of education. Over half of them had never been to school. Next slide, please. I'm gonna say another word on the domestic work burdens that our beneficiaries have. This slide shows the mean number of hours of paid and unpaid work per week, and I've broken it down by relationship to the household, to the household head. So the bar at the left shows the mean number of hours of work that a child or a grandchild in that household does, versus the second bar shows another relative, and the last bar on the right shows how many hours of work you do if you're an employee or domestic worker in that household. So as you can see, if you're a child or a grandchild, you're doing the least number of hours, which sums to about 32 hours per week, which is still substantial for a child or grandchild. And then going over to the domestic worker who's doing on average about 78 hours of mainly paid domestic work, but also some unpaid domestic work in a week. And this translates to about 11 hours of work per day, 7 days a week. Next slide, please. We also ask girls when they register if anyone in their household disapproves or doesn't support their participation in the program. And again, I've broken it down by relationship to the household head. And as you can see, over half of the domestic workers, this is the bar all the way at the right-hand side, over half of the domestic workers said that they have disapproval or lack of support to participate in the program. Next slide, please. And we also asked them about barriers to participating in the program. And what's not surprising is that 42% of girls in the program say that their burden, domestic work burdens, was a barrier to their participating in the program, as well as 21% mentioned being too tired or too sick to attend. So considering this picture of the girls, when we started to think about re-engaging them using their telephone contacts, we really had a second thought because we were worried that contacting them by telephone may have unintended consequences and may pose difficulties in their lives, including possible violence or retaliation. Next slide, please. So we thought instead of going wholesale to go and contact all of our girls over the phone, we should really pilot test what it means to contact the girls. So for the girls who gave us phone contacts, about 1,700 gave us telephone contacts, but only 13% of these girls said the telephone number was their own and they had their own phone. So what we decided to do was select out a subset of girls who said that they had their own phone and it was their telephone number. So we selected 71 girls and we had our child protection program officer call them to try and set up a later educational session with the girls and also to assess what it was like to contact the girls using the telephone numbers they gave us. So as you can see, of these 71 girls, only 22, about 31%, said that they were able to talk, they were free to talk, and we rescheduled an education session with us on COVID. So less than a third were free to talk. 23 of the phones were off, 7 of the phones weren't answered, 12 of the phones were a wrong number or invalid number. 4 girls were away without their phone, which really calls into question whether it was their phone in the first place. And 3 cases, someone else answered and was really quite hostile on the phone. So as I said, our child protection officer was the person who did this pretest, and she made notes after calling each of these 71 girls who she called. And I have transcribed here at the right-hand side what she observed during some of these calls. So after the first call, she says, the beneficiary is able to talk any time of the day. The background was very noisy, but she seems excited about talking more. But on the second call with the child protection officer, she notes, the former employer of the beneficiary owns this number and answered the call. The lady did not want to give me the beneficiary's current phone number, although she has it. The woman became very abrupt when she heard I was connected with the project. And in fact, a number of the people who we called were not the girl themselves. They were often the employer, and a number of them were hostile and did not want us to talk to the girl. Next slide, please. So I think, in this day and age, a lot of us who are working in this field, we talk about using mobile phone technologies as a way of passing messages or educating people or doing research. And I think that we really can't make assumptions about ownership of mobile phone because it does vary significantly across settings and across subgroups. As I said, only 13% of girls our beneficiaries reported owning a phone, which is probably over-reporting, as we found out during our pretest. Also in Ethiopia, we've had significant power outages, so it's very hard even for our own staff to charge their cell phones, let alone girls in our programs. And the places where these girls live are really very dangerous, low-income places, and mobile phones are often the most sought-after thing for thieves in the neighborhood. So the girl might own the phone today, but it's gone tomorrow. So this process of pilot testing, reaching girls by phone, really did show us we think that contacting girls, such as domestic workers, may have unintended consequences and may pose additional risks for girls. So instead of contacting all of our girls and keeping them engaged in this sense, we realized we have to understand more about the household dynamics and the situation of girls in these very marginalized situations. So what we will be doing is selecting a subset of girls who did say that they can reschedule a phone call, and we will be conducting interviews with them on the impact of COVID on their household dynamics and on themselves. So with that, I will turn over to Rima Murtada to tell us about the experience in Lebanon. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Annabelle. So I am Rima Murtada, coordinating the work in Lebanon. Next slide, please. So the main objectives of our program in Lebanon are to address the gaps in reaching and responding to the needs of vulnerable or neglected Syrian refugee girls. To achieve that, we plan to collaborate with Syrian trusted groups. We plan to identify at-risk adolescent categories of girls, mainly those who are out of school or married as children, through the girl roster tool, which is developed by the Population Council to help those NGOs identify the most marginalized girls in their communities. And based on the results, we plan to design pilot programs to address the needs of those girls. And those programs are intended to be delivered by Syrian female mentors who will constitute a sustainable delivery structure and will act as reliable authority figures in those girls' lives, and many of whom we know that do not have authority figures given the war and the displacement. We also plan to investigate the best recruitment strategies to guarantee attendance and high adherence. And by saying this, we do not only overcome the geographical barrier, we also plan to address the social barrier and involve the main gatekeepers in the girls' lives, particularly men. Finally, we plan to connect girls with services they need. Besides the obvious services such as education and reproductive health, we plan to, through focus group discussions with the girls, to identify other needs that they may be neglected by other NGOs. Such needs may be like, for example, having solar lamps because of electricity issues at the camps, or ID cards, or a list of safe spaces or other needs. In parallel, our second aim is to establish a learning circle initiative whereby we carry out regular meetings with other NGOs and UN agencies who are also working with adolescent refugee girls. The main aim of those meetings are to share learning experiences, collaborate, avoid duplication of efforts, which is very common in these settings, and improve the overall efficiency. This is especially important given the current challenges that Lebanon has been dealing with, the political challenges, the current deterioration of economy, and finally, COVID-19 related challenges. So far, we have carried out two meetings, and they were quite successful and attended by at least 7 NGOs. Next slide, please. So I will share the main girl roster results. We established collaboration with 2 NGOs, Women Now for Development, who applied the girl roster in 6 areas in West Bekaa, targeting mainly Syrian refugees, and Basma and Zaytouni, who applied the girl roster in 2 camps in Beirut, Birj al-Barajni and Shatila camps, targeting Syrian and Palestinian refugees. I will highlight 3 main important findings in relation to education, marriage and pregnancy, and access to services, focusing on 10 to 17 year old girls. Now, the proportion of girls who never attended school was quite high. It reached 20% for Syrian refugee girls in Bekaa. Looking at girls who ever attended school, a large proportion of them are currently out of school. The proportion reached almost 40% in Bekaa. And the proportion was much higher for those living inside the settlements compared to those living outside the settlements, and much higher for Syrian refugee girls compared to Palestinian refugee girls. Moving on to marriage and pregnancy questions, which focused on 13 to 17 year old girls. In both settings, around 10% of those girls were currently or previously married, and at least 65% of married girls had at least 1 pregnancy. And the proportion was quite high in Beirut, around 80%. Now, with regard to access to NGO services, less than half of the single out-of-school girls had access to NGO programs in their communities, and 20% or less of married girls had access to NGOs programs in their communities that are unlikely to address reproductive health and sexual health. So these results confirm that there is in fact a high proportion of vulnerable adolescent girls, and that they are not well penetrated by existing programs in their communities. And I know for a fact that there are many NGOs with many programs targeting adolescent girls. Next slide, please. So based on those results, we plan to design a pilot program for 11 to 14 year old out of school single girls and 13 to 17 year old married girls, recruited from areas that had the highest percentage of marginalized girls. The planned activities that we plan to carry out before COVID-19 were focus group discussions with girls and community members to understand their needs, the best recruitment strategies, etc. This will help us to design the program content as well as the delivery mechanism that best suits the girls' needs. We plan to recruit girls and enroll them in our program and recruit and train female Syrian mentors. We also plan to identify safe spaces to carry out the session, and finally, strategies to link girls with services they need. Next slide, please. So before I move on to the adaptations of some of those planned activities, I will briefly describe the situation of in the country since COVID-19. So refugees are obviously at high risk. The overcrowded settings where those refugees live, the lack of access to sanitation products makes it hard to apply basic public health measures and social distancing. So far, the COVID-19 situation has been handled by local municipalities, which imposed curfews in some locations, as well as UNHCR and UNRWA, which focus on prevention, containing the transmission, and case management. Luckily, so far, and surprisingly as well, the number of reported cases, the positive reported cases among refugees was quite low compared to those positive cases across the country. But the recent detection of 4 positive cases in one of the Palestinian refugee camps in Bekaa has triggered fear. So the prospects now, fear overspreading remains very high. The imposed curfew contribute to limited access to basic supplies and services. And even if lockdown is over, we expect that due to the political instability, the demonstrations and the road cuts which were present before COVID-19 are likely to resume. So the limited mobility, the bad socioeconomic conditions, the additional, the limited access to services will all contribute to increasing the risk of child marriage and gender-based violence. Next slide, please. So given all those limitations, I mean, even if COVID-19 is over today, we expect that the limited mobility and the road cuts will still be an issue. So we carried out one of our learning circle meetings last week, and we shared some of the potential adaptations of the programs that some of the NGOs are currently carrying out. So any activity that requires physical interaction is currently substituted by online platforms to comply with the government regulations. WhatsApp is among the popular applications currently used by NGOs to deliver programs. Now, if we were to use this application to conduct focus group discussions, we need to think about privacy concerns. Most of the girls live in small households, and privacy is unlikely to be maintained. So another option would be using the writing function instead of the audio function. But given the fact that we are targeting out of school girls, and most of which are probably illiterate, this may not be a feasible option. Add to it the limited accessibility to a mobile, electricity, or even internet. So by utilizing online platforms that are applied recently by many NGOs, we may be unintentionally reinforcing marginalization of those girls. So one needs to come up with alternative and practical solutions. Some NGOs, like Women Now, are reallocating their resources. For example, instead of using transportation money intended to bring girls to their centers, they are using the money to buy girls phones or tablets and grant them access to the internet. In that case, one could think about one-to-one WhatsApp call to maintain privacy. Of course, the implications of that, instead of using focus group discussions, would be losing the interaction dynamic observed in a focus group setting. But we need to use the best alternative option possible. Now, with regard to holding the sessions, one of the NGOs mentioned that they are still carrying out sessions at their center, but they are testing girls who are who have symptoms. Now, this is not feasible on the long run because it would be expensive. And we also know that many positive cases are asymptomatic, and positive girls, I mean, girls who test positive may be stigmatized by their community. So the alternative option would be online platform. But we also mentioned the barriers of carrying out those options. So one of the alternative options is modifying the delivery mechanism. So we could decrease the number of girls per session and increase the number of sessions and mentors, but this would require more resources. Alternatively, we could think about decreasing the number of sessions carried out at the center. For instance, for vocational training activities, the theoretical part can be done online, and the practical part, which requires physical interaction, can be carried out at the center. If live sessions are not possible to be carried out because of the many challenges, one could think about distributing videos or pamphlets for those who do not have access to online, or internet or tablet. So obviously I cannot cover everything because of time constraints, but what I wanted to light here that there is no perfect tool or one size fits all. I just wanted to point out or stress that when we think about adaptations or alternative delivery mechanisms in these conditions, we should also think about the contexts and where these girls are live in, and adopt strategies that do not unintentionally exclude those disadvantaged girls. Otherwise, we would be defeating the purpose of our program. With that, I would like to thank the Strauss and Vital Foundations for supporting our work, the collaborating NGOs, and thank you all for listening. With that, I will hand it over to the next speaker, Sajid Ani. Thank you.
Hi, this is Sajida Amin. Thank you very much, Rima. Excellent and interesting presentation so far. I think I'm going to take it in a slightly different direction with a slightly more positive assessment of the feasibility of working in rapid assessments under COVID. So let me begin by saying that this is an initiative of the Population Council of Bangladesh, and I'll report on our experience with engaging with girls through phones in two projects. The goals of the two projects are to empower girls. They're in districts, five districts of Bangladesh, mostly rural areas, where child marriage is high. So next slide, please. Let me start by describing the situation of COVID-19 in Bangladesh according to official statistics, as well as kind of the timing and nature of the lockdown that has been in effect for almost a month in the country and is being enforced by the local government, by armed forces, by police all over the country. So in this graph, the brown bars are the number of positive detected cases, which shows that there has been a classic exponential increase in detection starting about the second week of April. As you can also see in the graph, as shown by the description on the left bars, that the imposition of a lockdown started very early, and following the first COVID case detected in the country and the first death reported in the country. Schools were closed soon the day after the first death. All flights coming in and out were canceled. After about a couple of weeks, the government instituted a whole series of stimulus packages because it became evident very early on that the lockdown had severe implications for the lives and livelihoods of people. Next slide, please. This slide, it's a little hard to see. It's mostly about where the positive cases are in terms of COVID detection. And because the pandemic first reached the country through migrants returning from China and Italy and returning to urban areas, the dark spot in the middle of the country is in and around Dhaka City, which is where detection is highest. And that's again a classic situation with COVID. We work in areas that are shown in by the blue stars, which you can't really see, but they're in mostly in relatively low detection areas, except for two, which you can't see at all. But anyway, there are five rural districts. These were doing the assessment in these districts where we have these child marriage programs, and we have girls, mostly school girls, most in Bangladesh, despite the high prevalence of child marriage, when girls are not married, they continue to stay in school. So adolescents are mostly in school, and that's where we work. We are working in partnership with schools in two of the districts, secondary schools in particular, where we offer skills development programs to girls. So unlike most child marriage programs, our emphasis is on providing positive alternatives to girls who are not yet married in the hope that these positive alternatives in terms of skills development, in terms of improved performance in schools, in terms of their rights awareness, will eventually convince the households and the communities not to arrange marriages for girls. The dominant pattern for girls in Bangladesh is arranged marriages, and that's what we see in our study areas also. These programs are run in partnership, as I said, with schools in two of the districts and with the Ministry of Women and Children Affairs in the study areas in the three other districts. The target group is the same, mostly younger adolescents, because that's who is still in school. Let me now describe, so this is kind of the context. Let me now describe in the next slide what we are doing in terms of rapid assessments, and what we the questions, the concerns that we hope will be informed by the rapid assessment. So we're in the process of calling girls who were either enrolled in the program or participated in a survey in the communities of three of the districts, whether or not they were enrolled. So we have about 1,000 respondents. The database for the phone for the program is, of course, girls who have been coming to the program and attending these skills development project initiatives. In the survey, the numbers come from a consent form that was taken. The steps we take in calling the girls is, we use either mentors associated with the program or interviewers who've recently been recruited to conduct a midline survey that was over by mid-February. And in the consent forms, we have phone numbers for about 90% of the girls. The protocol we followed is as follows. We in a first round, similar to what Annabelle described, we called about 50 girls at those phone numbers, and we asked them, this is a team of researchers in Dhaka who asked them about their availability and whether they were willing to talk. We basically were able to reach about 80% of the phones that were called. And there were no refusals in terms of ability to talk. As far as ownership of the phones, about a quarter of girls own the phone themselves. So the majority of phones are owned by another household member. But because these phone numbers were collected recently, we haven't had much problems connecting to the girls through these phones. So on the day of the interview, the actual assessment interview, girls are called we seek consent from them. Even though the previous consent was taken, assuming that, but we still wanted to make sure that we were calling at the right time. And then if they indicated it, we would call at the appropriate time. So far, we've almost done with the interviews. We have collected information we've been able to successfully complete about 70% of those interviews. So just quickly, the questions that we ask are about, a lot of it is about health knowledge and practice, about existing care responsibilities for girls, like most girls everywhere, these respondents have a significant amount of time that they spend in domestic work. A lot of the questions related to the pandemic was about the specific sources of knowledge, etc., but also about the impact of the lockdown on education, as well as on scarcity. This main question we are interested in addressing is how much mobility do these girls have? How much access do they have to social networks through the program? And to what extent do they continue to exercise those programs, and to what extent can we use these networks to reach those girls. The one result that's coming out very clearly is girls themselves are the most concerned about not being able to continue schooling. Schools are closed, and there is some indication that they may be closed as late as September. So then what happens to progressing to the next level of schooling? And of course, eventually we are interested in the implications of this pandemic for child marriage in the medium to long run. In the immediate term, the importance of girls' supportive caregiving role, and how can social communication and community engagement focus better on girls in the way in which Judith put so well, in terms of the connective tissue that connects them to both the household and the community. So stay tuned. We should be able to share results in a couple of weeks. And I will end there, handing over to Alexandra Machado.
It's an honor to be here sharing what our girl movers from Mozambique are doing. I'm Alexandra, founder and CEO of Girl Move. I think that never in time we have been so much connected towards the same cause, and we are just being here with speaking in different continents are a live proof of that. And never in time the potential of girls and women to be mobilizers, change makers, carers for their families and for the world has been so evident about that. What we want to share you today is practical evidence. It's like a business case that go beyond the words that I just said. I would like to move to Katia that will share with you. Katia is our program director, and I will come up in the end, okay?
Hi, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here today with you. As Alexandra said, I am program director, and I hope to share a little bit with you of our approach with crisis situation. So I'll ask you to pass to the next slide, please. So what you see here is a brief description of what we've done in Beira, Mozambique, last year. Probably many of you have heard of the cyclone that has devastated Beira City. And this means that all streets, paths, everything were flooded with water. So people's homes were, they all collapsed. People lost their rooftops, they've lost everything, and they were literally living in water. So what we did, because we had our warrior mentors locally, so this was all local women that were part of Girl Move, they were amazing on moving into action to address this problem and try to reach as fast as possible our community there. So the critical point is that these girls were the survival assets that we had there for an entire community. So even though a lot of resources were coming to Beira, they were not reaching these people. They were not reaching our girls and their families. And they were located in the center of Beira City. So our warrior mentors, they were able not only to track these girls and their families where they were, but they also tracked what were the available resources. And they found ways of making these resources reach these communities. And they did this because they actually led many things from being from sitting down in decision groups and forces that were created to discuss in many different fields, and our girls were there. So they actually sit on decisions, to strategically being able to provide the quick needs and resources our communities needed. At the same time, we were concerned of bringing these kids to school as fast as possible. So we started our safe spaces in July when the situation was still a disaster. And we started rebuilding one of the first school buildings that was in place and ready to operate by the end of the year. So this was possible because of this fast response, leading capacity. And I would say that these were these young women at their best with their talent, actually mobilizing it for the benefit of an entire community. Next slide, please. And here we would like to share with you our approach to our second crisis a year after. And of course, this is a worldwide crisis. For us, Girl Move, it was the second time we had to deal with a crisis of this dimension, and this time in Nampula. And even though Girl Move has been in Mozambique for 8 years, every year we start with a new group of girls. So we have started with 1,271 girls 6 weeks previous to COVID crisis have happened. And we suspected that very soon there would be a lockdown. We knew that, and our girls, they were connected to what is happening in the rest of the world. So they knew we had no time to wait. So they were really fast in action. So our early action actually was what caused us to reach almost 70% of our girls. So what our girls did before the school lockdown, they went to all the communities, they went to all the schools, not only to talk about preventive measures, but mostly to track on phone numbers so that we could reach all the girls. And as I was listening to Annabelle speaking about who are the girls that have phones, I have to tell you that less than 0.5% of our girls own a phone. So this means that all the phone numbers that we have in our files are from a mother or a father or a neighbor. In many cases, what we have is a phone call from a neighbor. So what we do is every week we have our warrior mentors calling, sending a text message with a challenge, and then calling these young girls. And of course, they reach a parent or a mother or a neighbor, and then they handle the phone back to the girls so then we can connect with them. And it's amazing the amount of reach that we've been having with this strategy. Our expectation was that we would reach much less than 50%, and actually our reach is close to 70%, knowing that the girls do not own their phone. And the reason why we do this, it's because it's very important to maintain the connection, because this is the bridge that these girls need to go back to school and to prevent themselves from all the risks that we are aware that these girls are. And I will ask you to change for the next slide, please. And this is the second phase of our intervention with COVID that have started last week. So besides continuing these phone calls with the girls, we went on the communities with a van and a megaphone, bringing fun and graphic information for the girls. And this was, of course, responding to all the safety procedures that we know we have to have in place. And this was an amazing way of reaching these girls and the communities in a different way. And many of the girls said things like, "I'm so glad to see you. We know we were not left alone. We know you did not abandon us." And this is one of the best rewarding things that we hear from these girls. And when we hear this, we know that it's worth it. And let me tell you again that the only reason why this is possible, it's because we have this women talent that we've been building with mostly leadership skills and a capacity, an enormous capacity that these local women have to actually do things and to make things moving. So they are the ones who are actually causing all this to happen and keeping the connection and keeping our girls in the loop. And I will pass it back to Alexandra now, and please the next slide.
So emphasizing what Katia is saying, how could all this happen? So how can we get this trade on?
I just call 1-800-RH.
This combination between the immediate response and long-term vision. Okay. So I think that's the common denominator in all of the presentations, that women are in fact for social responses. We don't have doubt about it, but the question is, how do we prepare them, right? How do we invest them? How do we enable them opportunities to be effectively warriors? So and this is effectively what is critical for a girl move in what we have been doing. The global connection that they have. So did you see that in our programs, the critical thing to have early action, and they knew that the lockdown would come. And so they were prepared because they are connected with the world. So being connected with the world, being incentive to immediate action, learning approach, correcting errors, and then again immediate approach, and essentially also maximizing the potential resources through a cascade mentorship process as a transformational process is in fact the essence of what we're doing. So thank you again. I will go turn to Angel in Guatemala.
Thank you. So if we can go to the next slide, please. So I will talk about the Creating Opportunities program in Guatemala that is designed and tailored to meet the needs of indigenous adolescent girls. So in these settings, communities have faced exclusion from the scale plans of government, meaning that most programs will not get there, or if they get there, girls won't have perfect access to it. And this is true in a context where 42% of the population is indigenous. And so in this setting, what we learned over the past 15 years is that girls are at risk of leaving school and of child marriage as early as the onset of puberty. So ever since the program was piloted, the approach has been to reach girls ahead of the curve, meaning that we work with younger girls on the side of prevention, but that we also try to pay attention to the needs of older girls. So working in these communities over the past 15 years gives us a sense of where to start with a response. And so ever since the pandemic showed its first effects in Guatemala, the government implemented a series of measures that included mandatory confinement, limitations in mobility, lockdowns that extended to the public and private sectors, with schools closing after the first case was identified. So in partnership with the Summit Foundation, the Novo Foundation, UNFPA, and other partners that have been with us over these 15 years, we are developing an approach to our response, and we are thinking of it in three different ways. The current emergency that we have, then the recovery stage that will imply some mitigation efforts, and then the resilience that communities have always had. And so that's what I'm going to speak about briefly. All of this aware of the self-determination and cultural worldviews of indigenous communities that have always promoted a sense of protection and a sense of collective action. So that is working and has worked in favor of responses. So what you see here in the slide is a recent assessment that we conducted to identify the basic needs, the critical needs that these communities would face. And so what you see there is the partners that we work with at the community level. So the program has to be connected now more than ever. And by program, I mean this community-based approach that has been described, where girls come together, usually in a venue. Now these girls are at home. And so we rely on connections with frontline health workers at the community level, heads of households and their skills to be informed, their skills to support girls. The young indigenous women that live in the communities that are trained as mentors, the teachers, the community leaders, and the municipal officers that can direct resources to these communities. And so the basic needs as listed by these key informants are food, water, both in terms of food insecurity, water scarcity, their regular access to basic needs, and so that has implications in their capacity to meet the confinement requirements, for example. And in terms of washing hands and prevention, medicine is also a challenge. So the next slide, please. So what we're doing is we're trying to learn the best way to respond quickly in two different settings. So communities where we are already working and where we have been for at least 7 years, and then our approach to responding new communities. So I'm going to start with the first one, communities where the program has been working for at least 7 years now. So what you see in this slide is a description of what we call a female-led system of social support, meaning that in this, in a single district, we followed a geographic cluster approach where at least 50 communities were identified and the program was expanded. This means that you have 50 communities with groups of girls, but you also have a group of at least 30 mentors that have been mobilized consistently over the past 7 years. So these mentors, to gain relevance at the local level, are not only supported with training, with leadership skills, but also with community contracts or written agreements, deals that we strike with local governments that not only help us drive some resources to the program, but also helps them navigate the system and become relevant as an organization. So as time went by, these mentors developed more connectedness and also a sense of collective organization. And so they were constantly working with communities in what we call a female-led delivery system, which has the ability to capture information on the status of girls constantly, whether they are in school and other key indicators. They have established channels of communication with community leaders. This means that they are a go-to reference in terms of accuracy and information, which is more relevant in these times. And they have the capacity to work both inside and reach and outside the household in venues, in schools, but also to reach the household, in particular female heads. And so in this setting, if we go to the next slide, please. After the first iteration of the program, we decided to invest in going beyond the traditional approach of, you know, just safe spaces, education, and started to work on the side of livelihoods, food security, knowing that the sense of exclusion and the effects of exclusion were going to have effects not only in this cohort of girls, but in future generations. So these mentors that you see there, the same group of mentors that I was describing, now own a farm, a poultry-centered business. They are not only working on the side of food security, because they are able to provide food, you know, and also support communities through information. But it also positions them, and that's what we're seeing, as a delivery network. And that's what we're trying to get a better understanding of. So not only through egg distribution, but also through the work with girls, these mentors have the capacity to deliver key messages. And if we go back to the needs that we identified in the beginning, what we're thinking is that the model needs to be strengthened, more connected. If we go to the next slide, following this model. So we know that there's an opportunity that not only we need to seize, but we also need to brag about in terms of gaining visibility and resources for these mentors. They have the potential to be not only the first responders, you know, and work in partnership with other people in the community, but also be there for the long-term emergency. These mentors have already capacity to respond to difficult situations, such as, you know, struggling against child marriage, doing their part on working with leaders to transform negative norms, the channels of communication I was talking about, but also they are able to identify connections to bring in safe resources to communities. So with this ability, we are now pursuing a model in which there are at least two mentors in each community, based in the community, that have access to a wider network of mentors that can be connected to these three dimensions. The first is side of the prevention. Our initial push is to reach the household with and to meet the needs that I was talking about before. So it's not only provisions on the side of food security, hygiene, but also information. You know, what can be expected once that girls are able to go back to school, or what can we do to identify those girls that will not be able to continue. Then on the side of mitigation, so once this communication channel is established, then what can we do to have the mentor lead some of the thinking in terms of targeting, in terms of reaching the households and girls that will be at higher risk in this emergency. And then on the side of treatment, use these skills that we've developed with local authorities, with written agreements, and with the trust that these mentors have with communities, to engage with local municipal services to guarantee that the programs that were developed as a response actually get to the hands of girls, and not only to the hands of girls, but also are more connected to the females in the household, which we know have a big advantage in terms of not only securing a better future for girls, but also working in favor of the whole community. So the key message here is that to deliver timely resources and information, we are going to double the efforts to develop capacities in mentors to reach girls and also the households. And then, you know, communities are eager to collaborate. They want to be safe and they want to know the best way to do it. And mentors provide that opportunity. So, you know, mindful of the time, I'll leave it there. Happy to answer questions and hand it over to my colleague, Kelly Harmon.
Thank you so much, Angel. Could you go to the next slide, please? So this is the Indigenous Adolescent Girls Empowerment Network Project. And we are working in several US states with Native American populations. But today I'm going to talk about the South Dakota case study where we're working. The map that you see on the slide here, the circles somehow got a little bit skewed, but the areas where we're working are in the highest concentrations of Native populations in South Dakota, which is in the north central part of the US. And not by coincidence, the poverty rates within those areas are also among the highest. They're among the top five poorest counties in the United States. And that is no accident. Health indicators are very bad there as well. Life expectancy is very low. High school graduation rates are incredibly low. The history of these areas is basically they were POW camps during the Indian Wars between the 1860s and 1900s. And so basically Native people were forced to stay in these very small, poor land quality areas with the influx of colonial settlers coming in. And so this has led to a lot of poverty, social isolation, lack of control over resources. And so we really are reaching some of the poorest girls in the US, and there are a lot of needs. Next slide, please. So this is a graph showing the rate of the ratio of American Indian population to non-American Indian populations of the H1N1 virus in the deaths from the H1N1 in 2009, and American Indians were four times more likely to die of H1N1. And then the orange graph, the bar, is current COVID cases.
and they are also four times greater among American Indian populations. Aside from the obvious comorbidities that we are hearing all about, including diabetes, heart disease, and poor health in general, on Native American lands, there's often no indoor plumbing, there's an irregular water supply, so hand washing is not easy. There are a number of non-English speakers, especially among elders in a lot of these communities. And so translating health messages is something that's a challenge. People live in crowded multi-generational households, and so there's really no way to social distance. There's a severe lack of housing, and so there's no way to isolate COVID positive patients. And also because of poverty and lack of food in general, places to get food, it's really hard to stock up on supplies. And so people are constantly having to go either to the store or the food pantry to try and procure their basic needs. Next slide, please. So South Dakota is one of only five states in the US not to have had any statewide stay-at-home order, and it's surrounded by states with similar conditions in terms of policy responses to COVID. But it's very notable that Native American nations who are sovereign and can make their own rules to some extent in South Dakota were very early to recognize the threat and to issue both stay-at-home orders and to limit travel outside of the reservation and travel to other people coming onto the reservation. And so the three places where we're working in South Dakota with the Ogallala Sioux Tribe, the Rosebud Sioux Tribe, and the Cheyenne River Sioux Tribe, they all had stay-at-home orders at the same time or even earlier than New York City did. Next slide, please. And so in South Dakota, we, with help from a couple very generous donors that we've had, we aim to train 30 mentors in these three communities, across the three communities, but we were able to actually train 68 mentors in the state. And it's notable that the group that are the mentors are the demographic that has the highest poverty rate in South Dakota. They themselves are about to move into household head roles. 40% of Native households in South Dakota are female headed. As Judith said, they are really the link between the older, the younger generation, and between outside resources, information, and people within their households. Young women are the least likely to die from COVID-19, and so they really are a sort of asset stock to invest in for when the next pandemic or epidemic or other environmental health problem comes along, and we know it will. Mentors are great at accessing information, processing information, and also translating it to both the older generations and the children within their households. So next slide, please. A lot of the work that we're doing with the mentors now include using social media to stay connected with them. They're staying connected with each other. They're staying connected with mentor groups across the state and within our wider IMAGEN network. We're using tools such as Snapchat, Facebook open groups, closed Facebook groups, TikTok and Zoom, a whole variety of social media to stay engaged. We are particularly targeting girls who in these communities are often living without either a parent or a grandparent. You can see on the graph on the right-hand side there that 40% of girls who are both 6 to 9 years old and 10 to 14 year olds are not living with a parent or a grandparent. Sometimes they're living with another relative or even with a foster parent. So there's a lot of lack of social protective people within the girls' household. So it's very important to target this vulnerable group. They're also trying to use Native traditional life ways that value gratitude, spiritual balance, prayer in order to get through this crisis, maintain their mental health. And there's also a lot of misinformation in Native communities about what effective cures and protective measures are. And so they're working very hard to try and combat that misinformation while also being respectful to tradition and culture that values those sort of natural remedies for health problems. Next slide, please. So we're working to develop an opportunity now where the mentors help map basically the most vulnerable households within their communities to try and reach them with testing, food, and hygiene. And some of the most vulnerable people within their households are people who are on dialysis. There are incredibly high rate of diabetes, people who are cardiac care patients, people who are smokers. Native people are 6 times more likely to be smokers than the rest of the population. So that also presents another risk for contracting and being very ill from COVID. Also, food insecurity is very high. People live in high density households, and there are a lot of elders in households too. And so we're working with them now to really try and help their tribal governments marshal resources to the households that are most in need. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Sophie. Thanks for the opportunity, and I look forward to the discussion.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so very much to the presenters for their thoughtful and informative work and for really highlighting lots of successes and challenges that I think we all can relate to and are facing in our similar endeavors. I want to take an opportunity to allow for comments and questions from the group. We have a few folks queued up, but as we are talking, I hope you will continue to send your comments and questions through the chat box. If you want to submit that question directly, you want to speak, then just let me know again through chat and I will queue you up. I'll let you know when it's your turn and you can go ahead and unmute yourselves. Otherwise, please just feel free to send them through the chat box. I'm going to start with Nadia Tadres, our colleague in Haiti, the director of the Center for the Arts. And actually these beautiful photos here were taken by her. I'll allow her an opportunity to explain. Nadia, I will turn it over to you. Nadia, go ahead.
Okay. Okay, so I'll just, I'll just speak for a few short moments. Everyone can hear me?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So here in Haiti, just to give you a quick overall sense of the situation in terms of coronavirus, we have only had 6 deaths here from coronavirus and 75 confirmed cases thus far. Although since about March 20th, for a little over a month, the borders have been closed, the airports have been closed, and schools and businesses are closed for the most part. So all of our girls are, of course, out of school. And we have worked in our organization to create hand washing stations because of the lack of access to water. We have set up, in the picture you can see one of these drums that are part of our initiative here. We have set up 5 hand washing stations in the communities where the girls live and where we're working with our girls. And we provide them with a small amount of money to refill the water and buy soap and sanitation tablets to keep it clean. And we encourage the girls, and we've been doing seminars and educational initiatives to teach the girls about having them teach other girls and other people in their communities to wash their hands regularly. And we have also been making masks, because we have a small workshop where quite a few of our girls are very talented and have been sewing and making masks that are pictured here. This is Dear Linda in the picture. And so we have been making masks, both that we are distributing to all of our girls and their families and their communities. And we are holding weekly seminars in all of the communities with our mentors, where we are teaching the girls how to make masks without sewing, using bandanas and elastic, and giving them lessons in terms of how best to protect themselves. Here in Haiti, I will say, and I will just add, that it's very, very challenging, because there's a lot of denial about coronavirus. And I would say, for the most part, Haitians do not, are not taking it seriously. And because a lot of the messaging is coming from the Ministry of Health and is of course connected through the government, they don't believe it. And in that sense, they have been very slow to follow the guidelines suggested, the mask wearing. And of course, out of need, they can't really isolate. They can't really stay at home. There's a need for them to go out every day and get food and be in the markets. A lot of the girls, their mothers work in the markets. So the stay at home order is very challenging. The keeping the distance, of course, is very, very challenging for Haitians. And yeah, but we're doing our best to work with our girls and spread the message, and hopefully have them spread the message in their communities and to their families and around them. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Nadia. And now I will turn it over to Karen Ostrian, who I believe also has a comment, perhaps a question as well. Karen, are you there?
Hi, everyone. This is Karen Ostrian. I work with Population Council based in Kenya, and do a lot of work on vis-a-vis adolescent girls, both on the research side and technical assistance side. And maybe I'll just share one sort of experience that we had. We're currently providing some technical assistance to a program that is for young adolescent mothers and pregnant adolescents. And initially, or maybe just a bit of background, Kenya, maybe a bit similar to Haiti, we have a few more cases, but since mid-March, things have been shut down, schools have been closed, travel bans, the airport has been closed, and things like that. So pretty quickly, we wanted to try to see if we could get these adolescent girls, who are, many of them are going to deliver in the next couple of months, or are, you know, have babies at home. If we could use sort of, whether it's social media or mobile phones, digital platforms, to try to keep them connected to the program staff, informed about things, both COVID related, but also non-COVID related resources. And what we found, I think, you know, Annabelle's presentation rung true, is that for the most part, these girls, A, did not have smartphones. So the idea of even like using WhatsApp groups or Facebook platforms or things like that that are available for disseminating information were not available to these girls. And then also from the mentors and the program staff calling them, they did not want to be contacted for the most part. They were worried that now that they are sort of at home with their partners, that people would be suspicious and that it would actually end up doing more harm than good by trying to sort of to maintain contact. And so I don't know, it's left us feeling a little bit deflated in terms of how do we, you know, there's been a lot of anecdotal stories about, there's also a dusk to dawn curfew here of girls, you know, needing to deliver and not being able to get to the hospital, or that if the mentors are going and trying to distribute supplies, they end up getting harassed by the police for violating like the gathering orders and things like that. So it has been a struggle in trying to figure out how to support some of these really most vulnerable girls. And on the flip side, though, separately, we are doing a lot of, we're starting to do or have been doing since towards the end of March, data collection around, it started as a CAP survey, but now a lot more on the needs of people living in the slums in Nairobi vis-a-vis COVID. And we're now planning to do data collection with adolescents themselves, and that we can see sort of what adolescent girls' needs are specifically. And we're being asked to do this by the Ministry of Health and the Office of the President. So they are quite concerned about teenage pregnancies and want the data in order to guide their responses. So I suppose that is one positive note so that I don't get totally depressed, but happy if others have suggestions in similar situations where phone contact and in-person contact really isn't possible. That would be really appreciated. Thanks.
Thank you, Karen. I actually want to turn it quickly back over to some of the speakers. A few of the questions that came in, I think, are quite interrelated into what Karen just touched upon. And I know Annabelle, and Katya and Alexandra talked a little bit about phones. And I was just curious, based on the questions here, kind of how do you address privacy concerns or security issues? Even you, Rima, in your work in Lebanon, making WhatsApp calls, I imagine, given the lack of space and the camps can be quite difficult. So if anyone of the speakers would like to address that, I guess I'll start with you, Annabelle, and then turn it over to Angel and then Rima.
Sorry, Sophie, can you repeat the question? I wasn't quite clear on what the question was.
Yeah, so there's it's more of a, I think, a concern people are having on the feasibility of using phones to kind of contact girls in programs when there's concerns about security and safety, some of the things that Karen just touched upon and others have been asking about.
Yeah, I mean, we certainly found that it certainly was a challenge, not only with our particular subgroup of girls. They are recent migrants, so they're coming from rural areas. They're very young, age 10 to 14 generally. So they generally don't own a phone. And then, you know, I saw a question about SMS. Well, most of our girls have never been to school, so they wouldn't be able to read messages on the phone. And have very little familiarity. So I think it's not a given that phone is a viable approach. And I think that we do need to explore other ways to contact girls beyond phone contact.
Thank you, Annabelle. And Sajida, I know you had something to add as well.
So a couple of points. One is, I think even if you have, as we did, a 70% success rate in reaching girls, it's important to characterize who the 30% are who you haven't reached in order to get at this, you know, what kind of bias these surveys may have. On privacy issue, I think we were kind of self-censoring in the sense that we didn't necessarily ask questions that might be deemed sensitive or that sensitive that they wouldn't be able to answer. And we also, in general, there are a lot of issues around the quality of responses that you get on the phone. But, and I think I'm now heading in the direction of asking the simplest possible questions, not these complex multi-response questions that that we tend to ask face-to-face. Having said that, and specifically on the privacy issue, I will be doing more work trying to understand how concerns of privacy are the same or different than face-to-face interviews, where at least in most of the settings I work, that I don't see that unless you require someone to go away and in responding to the phones, I don't see there being that much difference from a face-to-face context. But just one last point on more on the, not so much sort of survey respondent side, but on the connecting when you're not face-to-face in these communities. One point that Judith had mentioned in one of our conversations that I think is relevant is there's a qualitative difference in an unnamed, unfamiliar stranger reaching out to have these versus someone reaching out through the phone who girls already know. And I think to that extent, using remote devices should really be in combination with existing relationships, not these anonymous strangers calling. I'll end there.
Thank you, Sajida. Angel, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, I just quickly, I would say that, you know, to the point about what is it that we are doing to develop these skills, prevention, mitigation, treatment. We are planning to be in the communities as we did before for at least 3 years. So, you know, it's not just an approach that's going to be for the next coming months. So the partners that work with us in these efforts know that once we get to a place, we'll be there long. This means that we will use radio and we are planning for different phases of content delivery. And all of this, you know, will be adapted to what the Ministry of Education decides in terms of when girls will go back to school or the efforts that or resources that will be allocated for that purpose. And then also bringing in mentors from previous cohorts. I think that's a key strategy for us. There are mentors that have participated in the program, you know, through the years, that have the skills, that have worked with girls, and that have capacity to communicate remotely. So these mentors can serve as support for new mentors and help us bridge these gaps as new skills are being developed.
Thank you so much, Angel. And since we're talking about this kind of effort to mobilize mentors, that question that you're addressing, I'm wondering, the warrior mentor group, for which we've got a lot of really wonderful comments on that term, Katia and Alexandra, I don't know if you want to add to what Angel has been saying about the timing, especially it takes to kind of mobilize mentors from the start of a crisis.
Do you want me to talk about the conversation we are having on the phones or mobilizing warrior mentors?
Why don't you touch upon both? There were questions about both of those.
Okay. Sure. Okay, so first let me, just to follow up or follow through with the phone conversation, we had no clue if this would work before we started. And of course, we asked the phone owners permission to do this. Now, let me tell you that about 50% of our girls have a hard time reading. So we have to engage the person that owns the phone to help read whatever the message we are sending. So this is a great way of engaging the people that owns the phone, even if it is the mother, the father, or the neighbor next door. And so we found out that as for the text message, now it hasn't been perfect. Sometimes it's not delivered, or it is delivered, but then there is not as much explanation about it. But anyway, overall, the girls are very happy that we are reaching out to them. And then on the same week after the text message, we have our warrior mentors calling them. And this is a very important moment where the girls actually feel that we care. And about one of the questions was related with issues with, you know, if something is going on or privacy or concern issues. And we feel that over the phone. We know when the girls don't feel comfortable about talking, or they just respond yes and no. And we are still doing case management. And that means that we pay attention to that, and we figure out a way of trying to know what it's going on. If that means talking with a representative of the community that we are in touch with that might know what it's going on, or even going to the field. And we are already working on doing that, of course, with all the safety measures and all that. And let me tell you that this contact with the girls over phone has been very successful. We feel that the girls are very engaged, and some of them are looking forward to receive that call. Which is a really good sign. And it's not easy. Sometimes we have to call them 20 times so that we can actually reach them, because it's not their phone and they don't carry it around. Now, about the question related with the warrior mentors, remember that first, and I think we are all in the same page on what I'm about to say. First, we know how much power these women naturally have because they belong to these communities. They have a lot of talent. And we know, as Judith has said right at the beginning, that they are the first responders. And what we do in Girl Move is that we build from what we know that they already have. We build on into their leadership skills and talents. And this means that they are even more ready to action now and to lead interventions that we never thought they would be possible if we didn't look at these women as the power that they have to actually move the world around. So I believe this is one of the strengths.
Just adding some point to Katia in terms of alternative ways to reach girls beyond phone. We are testing going to the communities with selected staff with vans, and the effect, the fun, and the amusing, taking all the health conditions, of course, but the fun and the amusing part that is being provided is very important for communities that are isolated. So it's another way that we are testing, and so far we have been getting good results. Okay.
Thank you so much, Alexandra and Katia. If there's no more responses from our featured speakers, I do want to turn it back to some of our participants. Emily Boost, if you don't mind, I will unmute you, and if you can introduce yourself and ask your question, that would be great.
Sure. Can you hear me all right?
Yes.
Yeah, great. Yes, thank you so much for the excellent presentations to everyone. It's been really interesting and inspiring to hear all of your thoughts on your COVID response and your girl programming. I'm the gender advisor on DFID's Girls Education Program, which is a global portfolio of about 40 projects around the world. And our grantees are now also planning their COVID adaptations and response. So your webinar is very timely. We're thinking right now also about those girls that we can't reach by phone and are trialing various approaches to reach out to them in the communities, both so that we can continue to engage them in activities, but also to keep track of them to ensure they're safe. So that last question from Karen around reaching the hardest to reach and girls that are not easy to contact is also something that we're thinking about a lot right now. But my other question is around where projects are still trying to do some form of girls club and safe spaces, where they're still meeting in person, whether less frequently or in smaller groups. Given the lockdown restrictions are very different in different locations, I'm wondering how many of you are still able to do some version of this? And can you tell us more about the considerations that are needed? So whether that's, you know, parental and community engagement or considerations around girls' safety and just general COVID-related risks. Thank you.
So I think I will turn that back to the speakers. And of course, again, if anyone on the line would like to respond to some of the questions that are being posed or ask questions themselves, please just let me know and I'll be happy to cue you. You can make this more of a dialogue instead of people sending things through chat. Would any of the speakers like to respond to Emily's question to start? If you'd like to, I'll just allow you can go ahead and unmute yourselves. Okay, well, I know we have a response from the audience, so one moment. Ilya, go ahead. Hold on. There you go, go ahead.
Well, thank you, Sophie. Hi, this is Ilya at Global Trauma Project. I am so thrilled with this webinar. Thank you, Sophie, so much. This has probably, I think, been the best webinar that I've attended since COVID. So thank you. Regarding Emily's question, I wanted to say that this is something that we've been talking quite a lot about or exploring with our group in coastal Kenya. In terms of like, we are still technically able to gather in small groups of up to five people here. And we've talked with our local community of practice, the Angaza Collective here, about the possibility of trying to implement more in-person in a very, you know, safe and contained kind of way, using face masks and social distancing. We've talked about a couple different potential strategies for that, being, you know, having somebody that could even go door to door and even share video messaging through, you know, a device that can be wiped down and things, and also potentially still having some very small in-person safe space kind of groups, again, using the masks and distancing and things like this. So far, our group has basically rejected these strategies for right now. This leads me to a question as well, a continued question, because we initially were really looking at, you know, what types of technology devices, whether it be phones or WhatsApp or things, could potentially be useful. We're experiencing the same kinds of things that other people have discussed. And so that's why we were thinking about some of these potential in-person strategies. But basically, our community of practice has kind of rejected these strategies as of now, given, you know, a number of various other concerns regarding kind of safety and security, both for the girls and for the mentors themselves as well, which is now taking us back to, you know, the options only of kind of, you know, online or virtual kinds of things, which led me to just one additional question, Sophie, if it's okay, which was, I was wondering, especially in for those in targeting kind of the 9 to 17-year-old, you know, vulnerable girls, and given that the issues and the concerns regarding the technology issues around privacy and you know, other safety and security kinds of concerns with using WhatsApp or phones and things, I was wondering if people have been implementing and kind of shifting into doing more work with caregivers or full family, household kinds of interventions, and if anyone has had any success or what the thoughts are in terms of shifting in that way, which is a little bit different from focusing strictly on the girls themselves and in the kind of safe spaces that we might be used to thinking about. I'm wondering about that, given the technology concerns.
Thank you, Ilya. So I think there's a few other reactions to Emily's comments, and I'm sure people have some response to what Ilya said as well. So I'm gonna turn it over first to Wenceslas, our colleague at Batanga Foundation in Benin. Wence, if you could just go ahead and unmute yourself, because you're on the list three times, so I'm not sure which part of you to unmute, and go ahead and respond to Emily, that would be great. Wence, I think you just started, but you can you please go ahead if you have a response?
Hey, Emily. Hi, great. Sophie.
Hi, Wence, go ahead.
Okay.
Sorry, did you have a comment, Wence, or was it Caitlin, your colleague Caitlin? I think it might have been Caitlin. Caitlin, if you can go ahead and make your comment, that would be great. Thank you.
Sure. Sorry for the confusion. My name is Caitlin. I am the program officer for the Batanga Foundation. We work with adolescent girls and young women in Benin, and our model is based on convening girls in safe spaces using a local women network of mentors, like many of the organizations that we heard from today. And part of our COVID response thus far has been obviously we've paused temporarily our formal girls clubs meeting because our girls clubs are 25 to 30 young women and girls at a time. But we have, we're currently sort of piloting, testing out these mini clubs, which are all meeting outside in safe spaces chosen by our mentors. And they're distancing themselves with 1 to 2 meters between all participants, with the mentor standing in the center of a circle. A lot of it is focused on sort of non-touch focused participatory games and discussions, talking about how everyone's doing, how everyone's feeling, and just sort of maintaining that contact between the mentors and groups of girls. The mini clubs are less than 10 girls, so that it's always maximum 10 people gathering. The mentors wear masks. Again, all of the activities and games do not involve touch, and all participants are asked to try and maintain the 2 meters of distance. We've only been doing this for about 3 weeks now, so we're still testing it out, seeing how it works. In addition to that, we're recording weekly radio broadcasts. Our mentors and girls are actually using their voices to record these messages. Some of them are informational about COVID-19 prevention and transmission. They're given in local language, presented by Batanga girls. And weekly, we're also having mentors record sort of lesson broadcasts where the mentors, 2 or 3 mentors, are in conversation together talking about a subject that would have otherwise been a girls club session. It's again recorded in local language. We try to have the scripts for the mentors, the notes for the mentors be conversational. They're only about 30 to 40 minute long broadcasts. And then in our outdoor, socially, physically distant mini clubs, the girls and their mentors talk about the lesson that week. Again, we've only been doing this for about 3 or 4 weeks, but that's how we are attempting to maintain some sense of club normalcy while still respecting the physical distancing guidelines. It should be noted in Benin, all of the cases of community transmission of COVID-19 have been limited to Cotonou, the economic capital. We haven't seen any cases of community transmission at all confirmed in central or northern Benin. So our communities have not yet been directly impacted by this. We're trying our best to lead by example with these physical distancing requirements for our programs, because for the most part, most villages in Benin have not been reached by this information and reached by these sort of distancing requirements. So that's what we're doing to try and mimic the girls' club model in these times. So
great, thank you so much. And that's so interesting, and it actually does tie into both Emily's question and some of the other questions that came in through the line. So Angel, I know you had a comment. I'm being mindful of time, but I love that this conversation is sparking so many new insights and comments, and we're happy to go beyond 10:30 for those who would wish to stay on the line. Angel, I'll turn it over to you to respond to Emily's comment, question, Ilya's if you like as well, and the overall comments that have been made. And if there's any other speakers who'd like to add, otherwise I'll move on to another question. Thank you.
Yes, so just quickly, an idea of what we're doing, a reaction to what we're doing actually. So in terms of girls coming together in venues, community leaders restricted that because of the communication they get from government. So what we're doing is planning in phases. Phase one will be through radio at least 3 months. And it also includes identifying two mentors in the community. So if we only have one, then we are identifying two so they can work in couple, as a pair, but also trying to connect them through the community contract idea that we have to midwives, to the community leaders, to every possible resource so that they can support them in message delivery. So after we are out of this radio stage, we are thinking about ideas. So even sitting in benches with distance or going out, this idea of a local balcony in the community. So we have still a couple of months to think about that while we wait for what the government has to say in terms of when girls are going back to school. And then just one key message is that we are doing whatever it is possible to keep the mentors stipend. These mentors are not volunteers, at least not the way we see them. And so we are finding ways to acknowledge not only their role, but also finding the resources so that they have access to a stipend that will allow them to keep the roles that were already transformed before this emergency started.
Thank you, Angel. And I think we have one more comment. From Kelly, a short one, and then from Judith, and then we'll turn over to another question. Kelly, why don't you go ahead?
Sure. So thank you so much for the great questions and comments. So in rural tribal communities in the U.S., tribal radio is really one of the key lifelines for everything that people do, from road closures to food security. And so we are looking to use public service announcements and other things on the local tribal radio that everyone listens to. And we also had a small donor come forward to provide some extra stipends for the girl groups, which we call girl societies in our tribal communities, so that the food security, lack of protective equipment, other sort of supplies like beating supplies, journals, etc., can be supplied to girls often through mail order or non-contact drop-off situation. So, yeah.
Thank you, Kelly. And Judith, did you have something to add? I'm unmuting you.
Very briefly, first of all, and thanks to everyone. The temporal dimension here, I think, will be an interesting point for observation. How much can people stand for a month or 6 weeks? And I believe we'll see in most places, about a month in or 6 weeks in, both for provisioning and other things, there has to be some kind of selective meeting points. And for some of the girls, and I think Annabelle described some, they may have been confined in their homes as domestic workers. They may suddenly find themselves on mission to get water or something else. I think Nadia in Haiti said the same thing. So there may be perforce moments where they're going to be out doing things, which they're doing to help others survive and care for, which we should think about. And then just also track, I think across a lot of societies, the different stages. We're dealing with this highly, highly infectious disease. Ebola burned through very rapidly. This is going to be slower. Therefore, what begins to happen between, you know, week 4 and week 6, what is actually empirically happening in terms of movement? Obviously, I applaud all of these efforts to have the little mini groups. I think they're going to be, I think it's a wonderfully valuable strategy, but there may just be empirical breaches, which we then need to, again, get ahead of the curve and make them something somewhat better, you know, agreeing that you're all going to meet at the water point and maybe social distance, but have a little bit of social interaction. And Angel's group, I think he mentioned, putting messages in the egg deliveries and stuff. Just a thought.
Thank you. If there's nothing to add, I will turn it over to Sarah Engelbretson, who had a different question to ask. Sarah, would you like to go ahead?
Sure. Hi, everyone. Thanks for some great presentations. I feel like at a time like this, I know a lot of us feel that the challenges are overwhelming and knowing where to start can be tough and what to focus on, whether it be commodity delivery or health information. But I think many of you have started with a really clear sense of what success looks like for girls. Many of you have used the asset exercise and developed positive benchmarks for girls. And I'm wondering how that has helped you prioritize at a time like this, how to proceed and what to focus on when there are so many different entry points.
Great question, Sarah. I wonder if any of the speakers on the line to start, any of the featured speakers would like to respond to Sarah's question. And then maybe we can turn it over more broadly if there's other comments to that.
Well,
let's go ahead, Alexandra.
I can add that I think that we are pretty much focused about the objective that we have to do in terms of actions. This is gaining trust with the girls. So I think that the priority is the actions that help us build trust after this will be closed. So it's, and not all of the things can be done by phone, not all of the things can be done by mini groups, but yes, we have to prioritize things that enable us to guarantee that girls know that we are them, that we are there to them. Okay, so it's basically our criteria in terms of prioritizing.
Thank you, Alexandra. Do any of the other speakers have a response? I know in the case of Kelly and Angel, I believe that you have used things like the asset exercise or things like this that kind of set up these benchmarks that Sarah was referring to. Are there any other responses? I'll just allow you to go ahead and unmute yourselves if you have anything to add from the featured speakers group.
So Sarah, thank you for the great question. In the graph that I showed in one of my slides, you could see that there were an incredibly high proportion of girls at very young ages who are living without either a parent, any parent, or any grandparent. And these girls are at really high risk of dropping out of school, of attempting suicide, and of being sex trafficked. And so really those are the girls who we are emphasizing a continued communication with. And if the girl herself doesn't have a phone, it's trying to at least make contact with someone living in her household just to check on the girl, but then in ways that we can have a confidential communication, which there are a number of them if the girl does have a phone or can use someone else's phone through texting, messaging, etc., just to make sure she's okay. And then also be sure to include her in some of the ongoing group conversations that we have, and to really send messages to, you know, we hope you'll participate. So really focusing on those girls has been a major task.
Any other questions or comments to Sarah's inquiry? Judith? Do you have anything to add?
I think Kelly answered it extremely well, and Alexandra too. Laying this foundation experience, my earliest experience in a sort of health emergency, though a less threatening one, was tetanus toxoid in Egypt among the garbage collectors. And my wonderful mentor, Maria Saad, came up with 14-year-old girls leading the tetanus toxoid campaign. Not only did they get people vaccinated, especially pregnant women who were at catastrophic risk amidst all those cast-off batteries, but the memory that first of all, people came through for these girls, but as importantly, these girls came through for their community, validated them. And that was a very long-term foundation. It was transformative. So, and the food security has come up a lot of times. It's not just a matter of emergency food. It's really building the basic physical resilience. You know, who do I go to when I have a profound need? Who will actually listen to me? If we establish that, then this social connectedness where we sort of begin, that layer of trust, which is the resilience layer that is vital to, I think, human development. I see this is an extraordinary, it's a painful moment, but it's also an extraordinary opportunity for us.
Thank you, Judith. Are there any other questions or comments from the group? If not, I think we'll end here. We're a little over time and I don't want to take up too much of everyone's time. I just want to remind everyone that this has been recorded. There are a number of resources links you can visit for additional resources, and we'll be sending these out as well as a much longer list and with the recording and the slides. I really encourage you, Sam, if you move to the next slide, to visit the website. We're really keen to find a way, you know, we are all being inundated with webinars and conversations about this, and we're trying to think of really interesting, digestible ways to make not only what was touched upon by the speakers, but your experiences here on the line. I see you all sharing resources and information and insights from your own work. How do we make that tangible to everyone so people can also appreciate what you all do and learn from each other? So we will be sending out likely in the next couple of weeks something to elicit that feedback from all of you and to figure out a way to make everyone aware of these accomplishments, these responses on the ground. I just want to take a moment again to thank all of you, to really thank the speakers for their hard work. If there's nothing else to say, Judith, I think we can close it from there. I'm unmuting you in case you have anything to add.
Just grateful to all, and la lutte continue, bon courage, stay safe and stay sane.
All right. Thank you all. On that note, we will end the meeting. Thank you very much.